Good morning, everyone. I'm really delighted to be moderating this panel of luminaries, who you're all about to hear from. We have three wonderful panelists this morning to provide some insight on the California State Park System and how it's grown, and also, most importantly, insights on the challenges and opportunities that confront that system today. This panel's discussion could not be happening at a more opportune moment. It is fair to say that the California State Park System sits at a historic inflection point between its past and its future. After 6 years of deep crisis that brought the system to the very brink of potentially closing 70 state parks or 25% of the state park system, there are many reasons to believe today that we are seeing some light at the end of the tunnel. You will hear much more about that from our distinguished panelists. But before I turn the podium over to them, it's worth beginning with some words about the legacy of Frederick Law Olmsted Jr. and the state park system. He was indeed the master planner for the California State Park System as we know it today. He enlisted literally hundreds of people up and down the state to bring him recommendations and suggestions for what should be protected within California's state park system. He surveyed people as well as land, which he did extensively. The California State Parks Survey, as has been mentioned several times this morning, was also an influencer for the development of state park surveys and systems all across the United States. And not that I want to compete with our fellow partners at the National Park Service, but I just want to point out that the California State Park System gets 65 million visits a year. The entire national park system, at last count, the last figure that I saw, gets 287 million visits a year. So my point here is that state park systems here in California and all across the nation are some of the most important access that citizens of the United States have to parks, to open space, and to nature. When Olmsted made the choices that he made for the California State Park System that he recommended to the first California Park Commission, he made really important choices about the priorities for that state park system. And he made smart ones that last very effectively into today. In fact, when you read through Frederick Law Olmsted Jr.'s recommendations and observations in his 1928 California State Park Survey, you see not only the outlines of the state park system that we have today, you see almost all of the parks that he recommended for the protection of California's exceptional coastline, all the way to the Sierras and Lake Tahoe, and from the Anzabrego Desert to the Redwood Forest of the northwest portions of the state. The list of place names that he recommended as state parks ring through to today because they are state parks. Point Lobos, Silver Strand in San Diego, Moss Beach, Pismo Beach, Russian Gulch, Malibu Creek, and the list goes on and on. Olmsted was also an acute observer of the importance of acquiring parks that would not be islands, but that would connect not only natural systems, but connect themselves to other forms of land conservation. He envisioned not only a system of state parks protecting the finest natural landscapes, but also a system of statewide conservation by both public and private entities. In many ways, he was very much ahead of his time. But there is one place in which Olmsted's vision failed, the California State Park System. He failed to imagine the conservation world of the future that connected to the urban park systems. This is especially ironic because of all of his extraordinary work in the urban setting. He has, as we'd say these days, urban cred. But he did, as part of the state parks survey, draw a bright line between the California state park system and the rest of the park systems that he envisioned in California, of which you've already heard some and you will hear more today. But that bright line has not served the California State Park System well, and it's one in which you'll hear from many of our speakers today, we are working hard to blur. He may, however, have called out an important idea that resonates perhaps especially today, and that is that the intersection of park systems and the cooperation across park systems may, in fact, be an important value going into the future here in California and all across the United States. But despite his oversight, that bright line between urban and rural parks that he made for the state park system, many of his forward-thinking thoughts will not only became the core of conservation ethics or strategy, but they didn't actually come into play in many cases until many decades later, often when they were harder to implement than when he first proposed them. He was the future, he was the shaper of the future of California at a moment of great inflection. We can only hope that we have his tenacity, his vision, and his strength to hear the voices throughout California at this modern moment of inflection for the state park system. It is therefore with great pleasure that I would like to introduce our panelists today on this important subject. Our first speaker, and I'm going to introduce them all, and they're just going to come on up and dive in, and then we will have a moment, as we did with the previous panel, for you all to have a chance to ask them questions. Our first speaker is Sam Hodder, who just recently joined in 2013 the Save the Redwoods League as its president and CEO. With more than 20 years of conservation experience, Sam is guiding the league into its second century of protecting redwood forest land. He has spent his entire career overseeing land conservation programs from the remote wilderness to the inner city. Before joining the Save the Redwoods League, he was the California State Director of the Trust for Public Land, managing the organization's largest state program. Sam has managed land conservation programs in California, Oregon, Washington, New Hampshire, and Maine, conserving forests, waterways, green spaces, working farms, urban trails, et cetera, et cetera. All manners of wild spaces for people to enjoy. He has played a lead role in some of California's most visible and impactful park and open spacing campaigns in recent years. But perhaps most importantly, Sam is inspired by the social and environmental benefits that open space provides. His passion for connecting people with the outdoors has guided his career and ultimately brought him to Save the Redwoods League. He is a graduate of Princeton University and an enthusiastic explorer of California parks and trails, which he kind of has to be, don't you think? Our second speaker is Chiska Van Wyk. She is the executive director of the Valley of the Moons Historical Association. Prior to accepting that position, she has led efforts to raise funds for multi-million dollar budgets supporting local, regional, and national nonprofit organizations. In this capacity, she has created and implemented capital and endowment campaigns, annual major gift projects, built boards, led marketing and public relations efforts for some of the most significant and numerous nonprofit organizations, both in the Bay Area and in the nation. She received her Bachelor of Arts degrees from the California State University, Chico, and completed coursework for the Master of Arts at the California State University, Northridge. She has had a long-standing love affair with the open spaces of Northern California and is committed to natural resource protection. Our third speaker is Major General Anthony L. Jackson, who is the 19th director of the California State Park System and was recently appointed by Governor Jerry Brown on November 13th, 2012. We're still counting the months, I think, of his tenure, with great pleasure, and was sworn in by Natural Resources Secretary John Laird on November 16th, 2012. Major Jackson has a master's degree in history, which is perhaps especially important today, from San Jose State University, and he's also a graduate of the Armed Forces Staff College in Norfolk, Virginia, and the U.S. Military College in Carlisle, Pennsylvania. From 1998 to 2000, Major General Jackson was Assistant Chief of Staff, G7, 1st Military Expeditionary Force. And he has served in a variety of career positions within the Marines through all of his career until he retired, and has worked in some of the most dangerous arenas around the world. Before his retirement from the Marine Corps in 2012, Major General Jackson served as the commanding General Marines Corps Installation West, supervising bases across California and the Southwest. We welcome all of our speakers here today. Thank you so much for joining us, and I'm going to turn to Sam first.
Thanks, Elizabeth, and thank you, everybody. My name is Sam Hodder. I'm the president of Save the Redwoods League, and I'm going to speak a little bit about the history of the league and our role in helping to create the California State Park system and the role that Frederick Law Olmsted played in our history and in that collaboration as well. The league was founded in 1918. And this is a time when the conservation movement in America was really just getting started. The league founders were collaborating with many of the leading thinkers and naturalists and park lovers of the country, Teddy Roosevelt and John Muir, who had recently founded the Sierra Club, Stephen Mather, who was the first director of the National Park Service, were all collaborating with the folks that eventually founded Save the Redwoods League about these big thoughts on the evolving relationship between Americans and their natural landscape. And into this collaboration, into this group's thinking, was interjected the threat to the redwoods, that iconic American species. And this threat and the clear-cutting that was happening up on the north coast of California was all the more visible at the turn of the century, as right around the mid-teens of the 1900s, the 101 was completed, and the work that was happening up in the redwood country became much more visible. And it infused the thinking about America's relationship with their landscape with a new era, with a new sense of urgency. And in many ways, the redwoods and the icon of that landscape became a catalyst for the conservation movement of the 20th century. Now, the first California State Park was actually established many years before that, as was alluded to earlier. Again, the redwoods were involved. The giant sequoia of the Mariposa Grove and Yosemite were established by Lincoln during the Civil War as California's first state park. But the state lacked a system through which to operate their holdings. And so many, many years later, Newton Drury, who was the league's first leader and was our leader, actually, Save the Redwoods League leader for 56 years, he revived the campaign for state parks legislation. And that same year, Save the Redwoods League hired Frederick Law Olmsted Jr. to advise us on park issues. And that relationship ended up sustaining Save the Redwoods League for many decades. In fact, Frederick Law Olmsted Jr. was on our board of counselors for 29 years, right through 1955. The next year, right after the successful passage, right in 1927, after the league helped to pass the state parks legislation, unanimously, I might add, that the state parks legislation passed in Sacramento unanimously. I don't think anything passes unanimously anymore. the league recommended that Frederick Law Olmsted Jr. be hired to draft the state park survey that would help guide the process of advancing the state park system. And that survey, as has been mentioned, led to the creation of the state park system as we know it today. And of course, because of his recent work with the league, the Redwoods featured strongly in it. Olmsted handed in the survey the next year and then famously went straight into the hospital. It was a remarkably draining process, and it's no surprise because it is a significant body of work. And what really has been setting the tone of some of the conversations today is what has made that document so unique. It's not just a priority list of parks. It really is more of a social compact. It's a compass to accomplishing very specific social and environmental goals, reflecting his and his father's firm belief that parks help to make our society stronger. This movement, as it was adopted by the League and as it was adopted by the effort to create the California State Parks System, reflected a cultural shift in how the country felt about its natural landscape. Remember that the West, of course, was still fairly young at the time, and this cultural shift was reflecting a new perspective, that the wilderness and natural places were not just to be conquered for settlement or to be harnessed for industry, but rather for study, for education, for spiritual enlightenment, for recreational enjoyment. And another purely American and democratic ideal that we've heard quite a bit about as being so fundamental to both Olmsted's vision is that it was uniquely American. These beautiful places were not being set aside anymore for the ruling class or for the landed gentry. They were for everybody. They were for the grand public. Gotten behind on my slides, haven't I? That conservation ethic of infusing the land conservation effort with a sense of its value to society and its value to community was a critical component of the Olmsted vision, and one that is still core to the mission and vision of the League. And an historian currently on our council, Joe Engbeck, who's here with us today, wrote a great deal about how significant it was that, Olmsted's vision for conservation really reflected the constitutional right of the pursuit of happiness. It was the parks were our vehicle, our community's vehicle, for our right to for the pursuit of happiness. And from this work, from this survey, we have 280 state parks and reserves. 48 of them are redwood parks. This system of parks is the envy of the world. They connect all of us with the beauty of California's nature, with our history, and with each other. The mission of the Save the Redwoods League, we'll see, is very similar to some of the vision that's infused in Olmsted's park survey. The mission of the League is to protect and restore the redwood forest and to connect people to its peace and beauty so the wonders of the natural world can flourish. And that really does encapsulate well the dual purpose of parks that Olmsted defined in his vision. The protection of land is only part of the job. It's connecting people to these places. That is the real task. Olmsted said that to make the most of California's natural assets, two things were necessary. And I'm just going to read this quote because it's pretty cool. To teach the great mass of well-intentioned people how to get what they want in enjoyment of scenic and recreational values. And two, to curb and limit the activities of exploiters who would destroy the birthright of their successors. Again, not just to protect these special places from harm, we have to help people to experience these places, to help fulfill the park's vision of elevating society and making our communities healthier. The League and our partners have been pursuing this balance of protection, connection, and restoration for nearly a century. Olmsted's vision has marked really every element of our work since we first hired him in 1926. And since then, nearly 190,000 acres have been conserved, and much of it has been transferred and is currently owned and stewarded by the California State Park System. Much of that land is old-growth redwood forest, but for those properties that we've protected that were historically managed, we are working to restore the forests and watersheds to their former glory. Our education program has brought thousands of students into the redwoods, and our science and research program has enabled the leading forest researchers of the day to inform and support our work in the field. And I think what strikes me most about Olmsted's vision, and it's the theme we're here to talk about today, is that there is no finish line. While there is, to the protect component of his vision, there's a transactional element that, of course, has a beginning and the end. But that connection piece is constantly evolving. And today, we face very different challenges to that of the League's founders and to Olmsted when he first completed his survey. But in many ways, they're quite similar, actually, as conservation leaders today have a responsibility to keep Olmsted's vision in our sights as we continue to do our work. The park system that we designed and built together still has to fulfill its promise to today's California. And it's a very different California than it was in the 1920s. We need to invest in the care and stewardship of the parks that we've helped to create. And we face the combined challenge of a decaying system and an increasingly urbanized and disconnected population. While backyard redwood fences continue to separate us from one another, there are precious few that have actually stood at the foot of one of these thousand-year-old giants and admired its awesome inspiration and presence. I want to briefly illustrate how Olmsted's vision is alive and well in the work that we are all doing together today, and just for a moment talk a little bit about Redwood National and State Parks up in Humboldt County. This is a system of parks that's managed jointly by National Park Service and California State Parks. It's a World Heritage Site and home to 45% of the remaining old growth on the planet, and home of the tallest trees in the world. The league began protecting land here in 1923, and have protected over 50,000 acres worth of land. And in many ways, I see this landscape as a good example of the balance of protect and connect. There are 1.5 million people that drive by this park every year, and that's just one way. And yet only 400,000 stop and visit. Given how dramatic this place is, how impactful it is, we can do better. 1.4 million people visit Legoland each year. 4.4 million visit the Grand Canyon. And for someone who firmly believes that the more time people spend in a redwood forest, the better off our society and communities are going to be, we've got some work to do. Director Jackson, the California State Park team, and a long list of partners who care very, very deeply about California State Parks are working hard to keep Olmsted's vision alive and to envision a renewed future for California State Parks, one that speaks to today's generation and one that meets the needs of today's California. And one important way to do that is simply by outreach, trying to tell the story better of what these resources really are. And to that end, Save the Redwoods League has been working with California State Parks to generate more material, current material and free material that we can distribute both in state parks through items like this Redwood Vacation Guide, education materials that we stock in all of the Redwood State Parks, and interactive online materials as well that help the public to learn about these resources as they work to plan their trips. The more people know, the more they care, and the more comfortable they feel seeking opportunities in California's great state parks. Once they're there, the parks do the work for themselves. And the visitors tell it best, and indulge me for a minute as I let some of those visitors do the telling. Going to read one example of a recent Yelp review from up in this Redwood National and State Park zone. I'll put a couple of them up here, but I want to read one in particular. This is from a guy named Dusty B in Sausalito, California, who earlier this winter wrote, how do you rate your national and human treasure? Life decisions are made in places like this. Contemplations on family, career and your life are made on the beaches and forests here. Children's lifelong wonder and fascination with living things blossom here. People come here to seek solace, answers, or to just escape the modern world. A lifetime of exploration awaits. Come here and experience a wild place that is thankfully protected. The landscapes we've preserved in our state and our national parks are inspiring in so many ways, but in the end, I think Dusty from Sausalito reminds us well of what Olmsted told us a long time ago, that we are all in the business of blossoming lifelong wonder. These places inspire us and restore us and bring us peace and connect us with one another. And the accumulation over future generations of the experience that these parks inspire and make possible, that is the true measure of our impact and the true measure of Olmsted's legacy. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm just delighted to be here and to listen to all these inspirational speeches. We're very committed to natural landscape and giving people access to it. So when the Valley of the Moon Natural History Association entered into an operating agreement with the state of California to open and manage Jack London State Historic Park, we thought the key to our financial sustainability would be to involve the community and engage local public participation. With the notion that if you build it, they will come, we went out to non-park users, park users, school groups, nonprofit groups, and asked them, what do you want to see at the park? What's going to make this park relevant to you as a member of our community? We also didn't have very many resources, so we also wanted to know where the strategic partnerships might be that we might call on for in-kind services at the park and/or possibly get these organizations to think about the park as a really important resource that they would pay a fee to come and participate in. Interestingly enough, and as I listen to the presentations, none of this is going to be a surprise to you, but the answers reflect, I think, not only the state park's vision, but Olmsted's legacy. The first thing that groups or people told us is they wanted high quality recreation. There were almost, if I could break it into two camps, two user groups. One was a person that wanted to go solo, very competitive, a jogger, was interested in physical fitness. And the other group was families, seniors, who were also interested in fitness, but they also really wanted to be outdoors for appreciation of nature. The second need was, we want a safe, neutral place to gather. And I think what's so cool about that is that Olmsted early on said that one of the things that parks provide for people are recreational opportunities that nurture their soul and their well-being, and that they can be available to every person regardless of their economic status. And this was really important to us because as we talked with folks, there's a great fear that when a private organization with private management of the park, fees would go up so that we could sustain it financially. So people pleaded that we keep our programs affordable and accessible for all groups. Three different kinds of groups fell into this category. One was the sort of self-directed group. They wanted the park as a resource for hosting a birthday party or a wedding. The other was a group that came basically families who wanted something to do with their children that was educational, thought-provoking, and or just something constructive to do after school. And then lastly, there were groups that just basically wanted to come to the park for entertainment. And then the last, in educational programming, you've heard this theme throughout all the presentations, but school groups told us that if there was a way that we could create programs to augment what they were teaching in the classroom, they knew they could boost academic scores. The other thing that was really interesting is that nonprofit groups, particularly those that were serving at-risk youth, said, and I heard somebody say it earlier, I couldn't believe it when I first heard it, these kids have never been in outdoors. Gang, they're affiliated with gangs, but they're afraid of bugs. They can carry a gun, but they can't stand the idea of being outdoors. If you can create a program that gets at-risk kids out in the park and teach them some vocational skills and some soft training and leadership and teamwork, you'll boost self-worth, but you will be contributing to programs that teach these kids how to be better, more productive citizens in their community. And then lastly, local businesses, no surprise, and the tourist and hospitality industry said Jack London Park could be an economic driver for the valley if you increase the profile of the park both regionally, nationally, and internationally. In other words, in Sonoma Valley, the phrase is heads in beds. Figure out some packages that get people from San Francisco, from around the state of California, from the United States to come spend the weekend here. So our first thought, of course, and somebody said it earlier, is we went to all the wineries and we said, you know, if they buy a bottle of wine at your winery, will you tell them that they can enjoy that bottle of wine at the park with a picnic? And went to the local grocery stores and asked them to put together picnic boxes for us. So it became a community effort. In the area, so these areas, the four that I just mentioned, or five, became our key focus areas, and we started to develop programs in each of these areas. In the area of outdoor recreation, we began to restore the 20 miles of trails in the backcountry of Jack London Park. We didn't have any money to do this, and there was a lot of deferred maintenance at the park, but we reached out to volunteer groups like the Rotary Club, the Boy Scouts, the Sonoma County Trails Council, and said, have we got an opportunity for you? You can restore and help make these trails accessible and safe so that we can increase participation at the park. They came out free of charge. Park champions came along and helped restore these trails in about 8 to 9 months. We offered a $49 annual pass. It cost $10 to enter the park, and the fees are important. They now total about 50% of our operating budget. But for $49, we promoted the park as a natural, affordable alternative to the gym. Our annual passes, we anticipated selling probably about 60 to 75 in our first year. We sold 275 annual passes. It's just really cool to see the kind of repeat visitation these passes are making available to local people in particular. We partnered with naturalists. These are you see this on the trails all the time. Families are taking, or individuals are taking advantage of our $49 annual pass. And then we partnered with naturalists to create special interest tours. We have a birdathon for children, so we're connecting kids with nature in very interesting ways. We also have wildlife or wildflower hikes regularly throughout the year. We contracted with a concessionaire, Triple Creek Horseback Riding, and they provide horseback riding now throughout the park. In the area of social gathering, we started to redefine some of the park features and call them venues, and then began to rent them to people who were interested in having birthday celebrations or weddings. Weddings have become incredibly popular at Jack London Park. I don't know if it's the legacy of Jack and Charmian, who referred to each other as soulmates for their entire life, or if we just don't have a knock-dead, drop-beautiful place to get married. And we keep it very affordable so that we're competitive with the wineries in the area. We have now what's called, because of the families said they wanted something after hours that was safe and neutral, we created something called Picnic Till Sundown. You can bring a picnic basket with your kids and listen to local musicians who all play for free because they're doing the park a favor. We have Sunday musical concerts. We have what's called the Piano Club. It's a number of volunteers who are pianists who come in and play on Charmian's piano. This has become a very popular activity. We also have larger scale events, Plowing Play Day. It's a historic reenactment of farming at the turn of the century. Last year, we had 1,000 families come out for a full day of demonstrations and farming techniques. And we then contract with Transcendence Theater Company. They perform Broadway Under the Stars in the winery ruins of Beauty Ranch throughout the summer months. These are all Broadway talented musicians. They play incredible, they put together incredible performances. In the first year, we had about 7,000 people come to the park. In our last year's season, over 11,000 people came to the park. And it is such a win-win. 50% of the people who come to see the performance, who just come because they wanted entertainment in the park, can't believe how wonderful the park is, and come back, buy memberships, and become repeat visitors. In the area of experiential learning, when we talked to the schools, one of the things that teachers told us is they had to meet Common Core standards in arts, literature, and history, and it was very difficult for them to develop that kind of curriculum. They also said, and I've heard it earlier, that being outdoors augments what they teach in the classroom and actually boosts academic scores. So we brought a number of teachers together to develop a curriculum with a Jack London theme that actually meets the Common Core standards in arts, literature, and history. We had a couple of workshops for teachers at the park to spread the word and get them excited about this curriculum. And then we proactively reached out to all the schools and said, if you've got trouble getting out to the park, the Rotary Club's got money to transport you back and forth. The Rotary Club, of course, was more than willing to support that kind of program. This is just one example of the tours that we now have this at the park. The schools come regularly, and in fact, we've tripled the school tours as a result of this curriculum. The thing I'm most excited about is we created a program called Teens to Trails. At-risk youth can come out and restore the trail while getting vocational training in carpentry, landscaping, you name it. If they graduate, they also get skill training in what's considered important at job performance, being on time, working cooperatively, taking initiative, et cetera. If they graduate from that program, they get a certificate that they can attach to a resume that helps them get a job. We have a 19% unemployment rate, particularly between the ages of 16 and 19 in Sonoma Valley, so this is meeting a real need in the community. We also reach out to our low-income areas and try to transport them to the park for what we call a free day. During free day, we have the reptile rescue group. There is a wild animal rescue group that come out and do demonstrations. On this particular day, this is a guy, here's a living example of somebody who had never been to a park and was probably a mile from Jack London and some of the regional parks in the area. On that particular day, we had the reptile rescue groups out. They show you snakes and salamanders. Not my idea of fun, but the boys love it. And I came out just to check to see how things were going. And he walked up and grabbed my hand and squeezed it. And the look in his eye, I swear. You know, there are days where it's a real challenge managing a park, but that makes it all worthwhile. He said, "This is my best day ever." And then we also have docent-led tours. And in fact, that's Breck Parkman. He's the senior archaeologist for the state park system. He's teaching this group of people about what the land meant to Native Americans. So we offer specialty tours, interesting educational tours, anything and everything we can think of to connect people to the land and remind them of our interconnectedness with the ecosystems. The big difference, I think, and it doesn't cost anything, is that we trained our volunteers to take on a hospitality orientation. We don't refer to them, people who come to the park, as visitors. We refer to them as guests. From the minute you arrive at the entry kiosk, you have someone like this welcoming you and telling you about all the things that you are going to experience at the park. We have interpretive guides in the museum, in the cottage, roaming the property so that they can answer any questions that people might have about the park. We reached out actively to the community to recruit volunteers who at no cost provide essential functions at the park. All these programs cost us very little money because we've got talented people leading them and coming up with new ideas every day. Now, what is wrong with this picture? They're all Caucasian, and they're all old. So one of our new efforts in volunteer recruitment is to diversify our base. One of the things that the schools are telling us is that it makes it really difficult and challenging for our Latino community to come to the park when there's nobody there that looks like them, or nobody there that speaks Spanish. So our big challenge and what we're actively doing right now is diversify our volunteer leadership base so that we can diversify our programming. We have 360 volunteers now, by the way. What all this has resulted in 2013, our attendance increased by 77% over the previous year. As I mentioned, we have now 360 volunteers carrying out the essential functions of the park. We survey our visitors to learn more about what we can do at the park to make it a more pleasurable experience. 85% of the visitors that are surveyed give their ranking, their overall experience, a ranking of excellent. That's the highest score possible. We now have 35 repeat visitation, primarily people wanting to use the trails. We hosted 68 events last year, everything from weddings to anniversaries to birthday parties. And lastly, and what's I think most important for all of us, is we are financially self-sustaining. And in fact, this year we not only met all our revenue goals, but we have about we have a very small surplus. It's 22,000, but who's counting? It's not a walk in the park, but it's a great day at the park, Jack London State Historic Park. Come visit us. Thank you.
I'm going to talk to you a little bit today about the wonderful gift of our state park system, of gift to the people of California, but not just to the gift to the people of California, but I have been all over the world, and I've heard Austrians and Germans and French and Japanese talk about our wonderful state park system. So this is a gift to mankind, and it's a gift to mankind which I think is symbolic of why I am now, for some reason, the director of California State Parks. And so I'll give you a little nexus. You know, I was, and how many of you have heard me speak before? Okay, you can all leave. go on. You thought I was kidding? I was a young major in stationed in the Pentagon. Got there on July 16th, 1990. And they said, "Major, you're going to be an emergency action officer." And I said, "What's that?" And they said, "Well, you're going to be the guy that's going to call the guy who is following the president with the briefcase." And you know what's in that briefcase, right? It's Agamemnon, right? Is in that briefcase, the codes that set the world ablaze. And I kind of like, me, you know? He says, "Yes, you're going to be one of those guys in the Pentagon that calls and authenticates the President of the United States if the United States is under any kind of attack, nuclear missile attack. But first, you got to go through polygraph tests, and it's going to be a social polygraph test." And I said, whoa. I went to college in California. They said... And the tester said, "Okay, we have a special test for you guys." Kind of got me off the hook for a few youthful indiscretions. But I was there for 2 weeks. I had to study these volumes of how to do that, because it's much more complex. The red phone isn't quite what you think it is. It's a computer bank, you know, and I'm an infantry guy and a history major. And so the second week they told me, though, "You sit on this desk over here, because we can't even let you in the back room where you're eventually going to work until you've passed all these tests and profiles and everything. But you take the Europe, Middle East, Africa desk. That's the slowest place in the world. And, you know, we're evacuating Americans from Liberia, and, you know, there's nothing really much going on, so it'll give you plenty of time to study." I came to work early one night. You can only work 8 hours on that particular type of duty, and the guy was sitting there, and I was 45 minutes early, and he says, "Well," I said, "What's going on?" He said, "Well, really, the world hasn't changed that much. Saddam's still making all kinds of noise on the border." This is August, you know, 1st, 2nd, the night of 1990. "Is the world slow?" "Okay." I said, "Great." I said, "I'll go get a cup of coffee." I'll get my books. I went and got a cup of coffee, and I set it down on the desk. And the phone rang as soon as it touched the desk. But he was still sitting in the chair, and I was sitting on the other side of the desk. And he says, "Nothing." And I said, "Nothing." And the phone rang again. So in our minds, we're saying, "Well, you came to relieve me, right?" And I'm in my mind, I'm saying, "But I'm not there yet, you know?" And then finally, I relented, and I answered the phone. Major Jackson speaking. May I help you, sir or ma'am? Now, normally, whenever you said that, you said it so fast, the guy on the other end, the gal on the other end, didn't hear what you said, couldn't understand it. But there was a panicked voice on the other end screaming at me, and I couldn't understand a single word he said. I said, slow down. Maybe I can understand. It was a heavily accented voice. And he goes, okay, the Iraqis, they are here. I said, where's here? He said, the American Embassy, Kuwaiti City. I said, just a minute, you need to talk to a general. Within minutes, Colin Powell, the military establishment in the United States, and every one of my best friends were on the move to the Middle East. And since that August day in 1990, a natural resource, anybody guess which one? Has sent us down a path where we have shed blood and billions of dollars because we as a nation, the world, as part of our universe, has not learned what Frederick Law Olmsted, what you know, that the caring for resources, the taking care of our natural environment, or not taking care of them, and having greed for other men's, has pivoted mankind to war for centuries. And so the nexus between my RV, my being at home in San Diego with a beautiful gal, so why she hasn't fired me yet, I don't know, is that when the Secretary Laird asked me, 10 months into my retirement, after refusing many jobs, which paid a great deal of money, I was tickled and honored to become a real active custodian of the natural resources of the state of California. Because if we can teach the kids, as Triska's mentioned, as Sam has mentioned, if we can do the work of the California State Park Foundation and get everybody to buy in, to see value in the redwoods and value in Anza Borrega, then I will have truly done something. And my tombstone won't have any meaning much in the future. But any legacy you can leave that avoids shedding the blood of fine young men of all nations, not just our own, it makes it worthwhile to come out of retirement. So I'm here today. I'm gonna give you a little state of that. Governor Brown asked me, he says, why the hell would you wanna do that after being in Afghanistan and Iraq? And I thought they weren't gonna be shooting at me in Sacramento. Well, okay, now you know a little bit about why I'm here. Our park system is unbelievable. You've heard, and I really want to thank you guys. I wasn't going to give a speech after hearing the three of you, but I feel obligated because I wanted to shoot something. You know, in 1928, that's what we were, 17 parks, 15 full-time employees. We had, by then, we had lost Yosemite, you know, 22 years before. We like to claim that, you know, Yosemite, it was, and the Mariposa Grove, the very first state park, Frederick Law Olmsted, you know, the first chairman of the Parks Commission. But now we've grown, 280 parks. Literally, last summer I drove from the Oregon border down to the Mexican border, to the Arizona border, and the Nevada border. Our parks are literally, it says there 1.6 million, you'll see other 1.7 million acres. Just our visitor count last year was actually 72 million plus. So we're on the upside over the last couple of years, and that's a good thing. And so you know it is so diverse. It is the, gosh, when I drive around to visit, to get to know our parks, like some of you, you know, I've been busy doing other things. You've been loving and hugging your parks for a lot longer than I have. And this is the most diverse system. In the Marine Corps, what we used to say about California is the only thing California doesn't have is a tropical rainforest. But we even fake it when we did use it in World War II. We used to fake it up in the mountains above Camp Pendleton in Palomar Mountains and all that area up there, Cuyamaca. We used to train for jungle warfare there. But the only thing we don't have is truly a tropical rainforest in our parks. You can be at a beach in San Diego at a park at 72 degrees and drive an hour and be making snow angels on Palomar Mountain State Park. It's incredible. You can visit your heritage. Whatever nation your people are from, you can go to Angel Island. I mean, you can go to Coloma. You can go to Colombia, and you can see your nation's heritage. You can see what your ancestors did. It doesn't matter if you're Native American, Spanish American, Mexican American, German American. You can see your heritage. You can feel being a Nisei in our state parks. You can touch the wall of your great-great-grandparent at Angel Island. Yeah, this is a blessing. You can be dwarfed by a redwood. I even hugged one. The other Marine generals are all jealous. You know what a cool thing about this job is too? Elizabeth's one of the few people here who see me in my Ranger uniform. They said I could wear a Ranger uniform. The cool thing is the director of California State Parks has 5 stars. I got a picture. The guys were so jealous. Colin Powell had 4, just in case you wanted to know. Field Marshal. Yeah, there you go, Field Marshal. Me, Eisenhower, MacArthur, you know, Bradley. Do you know that I am the director of, hey, Carol, I'm the director of State Historical Preservation, right, Carol? She does all the hard work. I get all the credit. Thank you, Carol. I am the director of the Off-Road Vehicle Division 2. No, don't do that. Okay, thanks. And I am the director of Boating and Waterways for the state of California as of last July. Yeah, I got that too. And I got parks. I have 4 commissions too, plus Parks Forward. Whew. See, I didn't know any of this stuff before I became the director. But anyway, you have a wonderful system. Okay, how many of you identify yourself as African Americans? Raise your hand. Okay, go ahead. Oh, okay. Oh. Come on, are you or aren't you? Okay. 1 drop of blood. Oh, yeah. How many are Hispanic? Okay. All right. How many of you are European? How many of you don't know? How many are Asian ancestry? Okay. All right. Any Australians in here? Okay, well, do you know what you are? Any convicts in your background? I love Australia, believe me. The point is, and I heard Triska say it too, these audiences that I address are not diverse enough. And there are, how many of you are millennials? How many of you know what a millennial is? You know, okay. Well, raise your hand if you are a millennial. Come on, were you born in the 80s? What year? You're a millennial. Raise your hand. You didn't miss that. Who else? I saw one other hand. Okay, 4 or 5 of you. Okay, that's a problem. We got to start dragging. Are you a millennial? No. Okay. Yeah, I saw some streaks. I didn't know what they were, but millennials, if they're streaks, they're red and blue and green. Okay. All right, they're not your grandmother's blue hair, okay? But that's a problem in California. There is no majority ethnic group. And the audiences that I address don't represent the, you know, the scrambled egg that we are, the omelet that we are, and the taxpayers that we're going to be, and the assembly members and senators that we're going to be, and the governors that they're going to be, and the connectivity. If we had done what Frederick Law Olmsted did in Los Angeles, recommended to do in Los Angeles in developing urban parks, Proposition 21 might have passed. But I have talked to state senators who have said, hey, you know, let's say they're Hispanic heritage. What do your parks mean to my people? And this is going to be a very powerful man in the state of California. And I challenge each of you, the next time you come to one of these meetings, get an influencer from one of those communities to come with you, to sit and hear and appreciate and get them out to your parks in some way. So we need to kind of approach who we're trying to attract. And all of the demographic studies say we're not quite on track yet. Some of our major problems in state parks is over $1 billion in maintenance backlog. And, you know, when it endangers a cultural or natural resource, and this has been going on, and Elizabeth's been around the park system, intimately knows it a lot longer than I have, but it's been going on for more than a decade, not being addressed. And that's really too bad. Because we talk the good game about loving our parks, but so far, we have not really done the actions that would take care of our parks. And part of it has been parks itself. And I'll address that a little bit. But before I address that, I want to tell you, you are blessed as Californians, as keeper of our parks, with a workforce that loves them. 2,500 or so permanent employees, but there are over 3,500 temporary employees. And when I talk about seasonal employees, they are college grads from UC Berkeley, from Stanford, from San Jose and East Bay. They're from all over the state, our universities, who accept $9.86 an hour, and they can only work 9 months or so out of the year. And they're at our kiosk, and then they have to go away without, and most of your park rangers and interpreters and stuff, they all did an apprenticeship like that for some of them 7, 8, 9 years before they got a permanent position with health benefits and everything else. So we're blessed that most of our seasonal workers keep coming back for years until there's an opening for them. We're also blessed by over 37,000 volunteers that put over 1 million personnel hours a year for us to keep our parks open. I mean, people who do great work. Work that is cheaper, they do it better in the state, cheaper in the state, and faster in the state. And if any of you have ever been out to Año Nuevo, to any of you been out there and walked that boardwalk out there, that wasn't built by state money, state time, state energy, that was volunteers putting down a plank that beat the engineering standards of the state of California. We are blessed because without the work of those volunteers, and the seasonal employees, we would have crumbled long ago. So if you look at us, you know, in those 208 parks we have, and you all are familiar with the kind of the core programs, this just kind of formally puts it up. We're public safety is a huge part of our expense. It's something that we are examining the role of the core of our course. You know, the first rangers were not necessarily law enforcement officers. That became a big deal in 1979 in California. And so we're examining that, how much we invest in law enforcement, how much law enforcement is, our parks are divided up into 25 districts throughout the state of California. And right now, you have to be a law enforcement officer in order to be a superintendent. That is not something that I necessarily agree with, but we have to go through a myriad of paths to bring about change. I think we have 10 different unions, as well as civil service in our park system, and so we're challenged there. facilities is a very big deal. You know, I want you to walk away from our parks as a park user thinking that you've been to the cleanest restrooms in the world. I'm tired of people telling me how clean restrooms are in Oregon. Facilities is a big deal. Ladies, is it a big deal? Yeah. Darn right. Guys, if they say come back, you'll come back. At least that's the way my family works. Preserving, protecting our natural resources. That's why we exist. Our educational arm and cultural and all that, very important. But it's all part of that protect. To make sure, it's about seven generations since 1864. We're in the sesquicentennial year. I said that, sesquicentennial. You didn't think a Marine could say that, did you? Yeah, okay, I got it, buddy. 6 months of rehearsal, it works. Okay, recreation, it's big. Recreation is big, but let me tell you what, how many of you are mountain bike riders? Okay, are you spamming me right now? How many of you spam me this week? Come on, fess up. No, this starting at 5:30 in the morning on Monday, you all started spamming me. I have had 100 or more emails a day. I can't get to official business because somebody spread a rumor we were going to ban mountain bikes from state parks. And if the equestrians start, and I don't know what they're going to dump on my front porch. Okay, so you guys can stop now. You haven't made a friend, but you haven't made an enemy. Okay, if it doesn't stop by Monday, though, we'll talk about roles again, okay? But I'm serious. Somebody spread a rumor that we're not going to, that you got to deal with it. You're in a political world. Okay, I've taken too much time. I don't need to go through all of this. You can ask that in the question. But these are just, if we were a business model, one of my guys was musing, this is what we would look like. We'd have police, we'd have teachers, we'd have a museum group, go museums, construction, camping, we have all of that stuff. State parks is in the 21st, are we in the 21st century? Okay, I want to tell you, state parks is in the two-thirds, it's a way through the 20th century. IT, you can come from Austria on an American Express card, right? Or a Visa, or a MasterCard. And then you can drive up to a gate of a state park and be told, you can't come in. We only take cash. Would you park a mile down the road? Or put your money in an Iron Ranger. Who knows what an Iron Ranger is? Yeah. Yeah, what do millennials do with Iron Rangers? But that's where we are. We need to launch ourselves into the 21st century, and we're working on that. Partnerships. Valley of the Moon, the Foundation, Save the Redwood League, Semper Virens, all of these partnerships are part of the reasons why not only the park system is what it is today, realizing the vision and trying to realize the vision of Frederick Law Olmsted. And I was two weeks ago, I was at LA State Historical Park, really concrete, cement, old railroad yard. But LA begs, if they would have just listened to Frederick Law Olmsted. But they are so excited about 32 acres that we're remodeling into an urban park in Los Angeles. And it's because of the vision. I mean, we're trying to go back and make good on a vision that was already there 100 years previous. But without these partners, we couldn't even do that down there. They're in our assembly working hard. They're on fundraisers for us. They're coming up with new programs, new ideas. So we've got to continue to build that, and I want to be a real steward of our partnerships. The good news, the governor stabilized our budget this year. Now, we have been in decline for how many years, Elizabeth? 6 years of declining budgets. We finally, I didn't realize how effective as a puppy doing this was. But it worked in the governor's office. So he stabilized our budget. And right now the proposal is to give us another $40 million in maintenance money. So we're pretty stable. And one of the untold stories about parks is that over the last 10 years, we've given out more than $2 billion worth of grants that we can't spend on our own parks, but for urban parks and parks in underdeveloped neighborhoods around the state. And it's one of those stories that is not advertised enough, and that's why a state senator can challenge me on what we have done for his people. But we do have a good news story, and we have more bond money to support local grants this year. What did I do with my weapon? Okay. And then I'm just going to conclude and just tell you that we've got a new annual pass. We're trying to make ourselves a little bit more affordable. We have the 150th anniversary pass for $150. You know, our normal annual pass has been $195 for years. We have a $75 pass for just about all of our Northern California parks, okay? It gets you in for $75 annually. So we've tried to reduce it to make it more accessible for more economic groups. At the same time, if you're a Southern California server and you want to go to all the parks that you around the state, you still have to pay $195, okay? And we have a historical pass for our museums and historical sites that'll only cost you $50. And then for our off-road vehicle parks, we have an annual pass for $50. So we've divided it up into various groups, various interest groups, to try to capture more people. And our sales right now are about 10% over previous years. So we think that's working out pretty good. And this is our 150th anniversary, as I mentioned. And I would like for you, all of you, to get out. Just about every park is going to have a 150th anniversary celebration. You can click on our website. Our website is at least that up to date. It has 150th. Click on that, baby, and you can see what local events. There's a whole list of events. We're partnering with all the county and state fairs to have different events support celebrating 150 years of our state park system. And I think that's you all have to have we're going to chart a new course. We ask you to be a part of our team. We ask you to contribute in some way, bring an influencer from a community that may not be, contribute to organizations like Valley of the Moon and the California State Parks Foundation and Save the Redwood League. Get out, be active. I know you're the active audience. I'm kind of preaching to the choir, but at the same time, think of someone who doesn't have a clue, an interest in state parks or any other park, and drag them out. I've got two nephews. I'm going to tie a rope around. I'm going to drag them out to the park. Okay. Thank you very much.
I have a question for General Jackson.
Okay.
Given your career history and now the new appointment, it seems that you've got a great vantage on advising us as to where the downsizing and closing of American military bases is vis-a-vis preservation of landscapes in California or nationwide, and do the various branches of the military, or can the various branches of the military, speak in one voice about preservation and return of military installations to public embrace?
The mic working? Okay. What a great question. That was.
Oops, that was a great question.
We're a team. A little slapstick here.
All wet.
Listen, you know, I'm on the governor's military council too, which is kind of fun because we met for 2 days this week. The first 2 days of this week, I was, spent 8 hours plus with his military advisory council. And we had all of the senior military leaders from the Air Force, Navy, Marines, Coast Guard, and the Army in the state capitol sitting in the room with us, and each of them gave a presentation. And each one of those presentations did address things like the environment, energy conservation, water conservation, things that are vital to us as Californians and vital to us in state parks. The very interesting thing is that If you go down to Camp Pendleton, I can say this because I was the commanding general, right? There are like 18 endangered species in San Diego County. 17 of them are on Camp Pendleton. And if it wasn't for Camp Pendleton, there would only be one endangered species in the San Diego County, most likely, that would be surviving. There is no better stewards. I mean, and I can say this honestly, and you can go to your military bases. I had 118 environmentalists and archaeologists and various other sciences, civilians, that were working on our base to preserve and protect. It's kind of amazing. A tank would drive over sand, you know, and then it would rain. And then the Aurora toad eggs would hatch in the tank's tread, and the tank would have to find another way back to wherever it came from to avoid that. In 29th Palms, California, which is the principal training base for all Marines in the world for actual preparation to go to combat, where they actually fire big weapons and drop big bombs. They also raise and breed the desert tortoise to ensure that it survives. So, and the governor, and it came out, quite frankly, the military is the number one producer of self-sustaining renewable energy of any organization in the state of California. So, and there are groups that that are meeting routinely with the military. I'm sort of out of that now, except I send a representative to represent state parks at these, like the Desert Renewable, what is it? DREC, Desert Energy Renewal. Yeah, there you go. Thanks a lot. Gosh, I love my deputies. They're always watching my back. But so there is I would say, you know, and we have San Andres State Beach is on one of our military bases at Camp Pendleton. So we have been since the 80s super conscious of environmental issues on military installations for the preservation, first, of the military mission, but it comes right in sync with, you know, the value system of the military and not just tearing things up anymore. I mean, that's kind of gone by the wayside, you know. It's really amazing. You want to know where the bad guys are at Camp Pendleton? Look for the blue porta-johns, you know, because you used to dig, you know, cat holes and go on, but you don't do that anymore. So you get up on a hill, I see a blue porta-john. Okay, that's where the bad guys are. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, sorry. If I may toot your horn a little bit for you.
Thank you.
General Jackson was working at Camp Pendleton, many of you know that San Onofre State Beach is actually on Camp Pendleton. It's a lease arrangement with the Marines and has been for a long time. And he was absolutely essential in making sure that San Onofre was protected from a toll road proposal, which still is out there hovering around, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But we've won 4 times, and I think we may have to win 12 times, or 9 at least, right? 9 lives, to make sure that toll road is really dead. But he was an extraordinary proponent of protecting Camp Pendleton, not only for its military mission, but also for its state parks mission at San Onofre State Beach. And also, I think it's important and relevant to recognize that many of the protected lands that now currently exist. I mean, in San Onofre, there's actually protection from the ocean all the way to the mountains. That never would have happened unless there was a military base protecting that land. It would be all homes and industry now, and that's true at the Presidio, not very far away. It's true in Monterey, and in many, many other places up and down. Fort Hunter Liggett is actually protecting some of the most important coastal Oaklands in California now as still a remaining active military base. So I think we have to be very grateful to our colleagues in the military for making sure that some of that land is going to be available to the public in the future. So other questions for our panelists? Now I know there were hands up. One way back here and another gentleman up here and back there as well.
I have a question about the redeployment of military forces. I know there's a reduction in the number of military, the reduction of the military, and It seems like the military is very diverse, and it seems like some of those troops are being directed toward IT. I'm actually an electrical engineer in Silicon Valley, so I am aware of that a little bit. But it seems like there would be an opportunity to, if there is this partnership between conservation and the military, some of those troops could at least be introduced to areas such as archaeology or conservation biology or planning. And I'm wondering if there is anything being done in that area.
Are you directing that question at Sam?
The governor, he's concerned about a related issue. I don't know if you all realize that 10% of the United States military are Californians. Yeah, that 20% of the returning veterans each year are Californians. And that you have this influx of people who came in the military at between 18 and 19 years old, and they're going to be coming out, and they're coming out now at between 30 and 35,000 annually into California. And so one of the reasons why we have this military council that the governor set up, very distinguished, both military and civilian folks are part of that council, is because just about one in every 10 defense dollars also comes into California, aerospace industry, all kinds of, and besides the direct impact, San Diego County alone, $32 billion a year of military payrolls. And I mean, when I was a kid growing up, I grew up a part of my life on Oakland Army Base. And my dad was a sergeant in the Army. And when I was a kid, I saw a sailor, I saw a soldier, an airman on the streets of Oakland every single day in uniform. And all that evaporated, right? Because California didn't, in the 70s and 80s, didn't defend its bases. So all the bases we used to have in the Bay Area are now in Georgia and Mississippi, okay? And Everett, Washington. So the California, the governor recognized that, and he recognized these veterans coming home, and they have skills that people in California can use, or our universities need to learn to accept them and grab hold of them. I'm going to San Jose State next week to talk to a whole group of veterans about reincorporating into society writ large. It's really not that hard. It's just, you know, don't be afraid of where you're going, son, daughter, and public, don't be afraid of them, and they know how to work really hard. So we've got some groups going that right now it's a big issue for the whole country, but it's biggest for California. So we do have to address that, and there's some that just want to be outdoors, and there's some that we can incorporate into any one of our occupations to support our park. So that's a good idea, and I'm going to meet with Secretary of California Veterans Affairs, Secretary Gravitt, next week. And I told him I would like to figure out a way that I can just screen and hire X number of veterans and put them to work, and it'd be an apprenticeship in state parks to permanent positions. But they have to get, these are not people, they've had more than a livable wage for, you know, 4 years. So I'm not talking about a Mickey D's worker. I'm talking about somebody that's in an apprentice program, they got a wife and two kids, or they're single and they want a job leading to a profession. But it has to be a livable wage. It can't be a minimum wage. So we're going to sit down. We're brainstorming that right now. If you got any ideas, Elizabeth knows my email. I know that. So do the bikers, the mountain bikers.
It's easy to find.
It's kind of obvious if you think about it. I don't know who can answer this question, but wildlife do not respect boundaries. So I was wondering if there's any way that the California State Park system can take more responsibility for the wildlife throughout the state, not just inside their boundaries.
Anybody want to leave that off?
Well,
go ahead.
Yeah. I'll take a start. I'm sure folks have other things to say. The beauty of, and I would say that wildlife aren't the only species that don't care so much about boundaries. Many park users don't particularly care either. And it
becomes fairly irrelevant fairly quickly who owns and manages a particular recreational land or a particular habitat restoration project. And it and the strategy then, and the beauty or one of the fortunate elements of California is there are a lot of different shoulders to the wheel, a lot of different entities that are owning and managing land. What we're realizing really in response to both issues, both the fact of managing habitat across ownerships and managing recreation at that same scale, is that coordination between the different agencies, whether it be between state agencies alone or local, regional, state, and federal, so that there can be region-wide planning of habitat management, of watershed protection, and of recreational management as well. So I think that point is a good one, not lost on the various agencies that are stewarding these resources, and it's increasingly important for us to figure it out, especially as these habitats are moving.
And one of the real interesting things is there is no such thing as white space on this earth. You know, a lot of times people say, well, we're looking for the white space to do something, whether it's solar panels or whether it's, wind turbines or, you know, the birds are in the air, right? And they own that space. On the ground, there's a migration routes. Now, we can partner with people to figure out what's the best land. You know, the GIS system, which does the satellite mapping of everything. We can map just about everything. And it's where the antelope migrate, where the deer migrate, which bird routes fly. And we can continue to analyze with that kind of data what are the right places to do the right things to have the minimal impact. And this is becoming our state. I think when I first moved here in 63 or so, we had 17 million people. We got 40 million people now. And we didn't use that kind of data to plan where we put things. I mean, we got oil pipelines that lead from, from Texas underground all the way to California, bringing gasoline to the state. And all of a sudden, somebody wants to do something there, and then you say, wait a minute. We're the bird strikes and things like that. So we have to do a better job of using data to come to our decisions, even in developing our parks.
I think we've almost wrapped up our time here, so I just want to take a minute and thank all of our great panelists today, and Linda, did you want to take one more? Did you? Okay,
one more
great.
Question.
Yeah. Good.
Thanks. Hello, my name's Sherilyn Waddell, and this question is actually for all three of you. Last year, the Presidio Trust met its congressional requirement to make the Presidio economically self-sufficient. And Jack London State Park, I know, was one of the ones I believe was closed by California State Parks. And now we've had it reported that you're economically self-sufficient. In fact, you have an abundance. Is economic self-sufficiency in public-private partnerships the future for California State Parks and other models throughout the United States?
Who would like to start on that? Mm. Or do we want to just say, no?
I will say that there is an inherent contradictory tension between preservation and use. A lot of the funds that we have raised are a result of our bringing people to the park. And that can run the risk of impacting natural resources. So answering your question, I think that financial sustainability has to be the future for California state parks. I don't see a lot of government funding in the future for parks. I actually see it coming full circle. Parks were created by people, by citizens, and I think now citizens are reclaiming parks and redefining them so that they're more relevant to the community. And our challenge is to not only figure out how we can make our programming financially sustainable, but do it in a way that we don't lose the experience that we want to create for people when they're at the park. When I talked about the fact that we survey our visitors to ask them, what they liked, what they didn't like, et cetera, And one of the main themes that we always get back is, I absolutely loved my experience. Please don't turn this into London land. People do really appreciate parks for the serenity and inspiration they get from being out in the wild and feeling like they have that for themselves without being crowded. Does that answer your question a little bit?
But I would have a different take.
Okay.
I think you absolutely need public funding and some public responsibility. Mm-hmm. I would have to quadruple the expense for people to come into our parks to raise the $600+ million you saw up on the board. Mm-hmm. And I generated $110 million of revenues last year, which was an all-time record for parks. But the state still puts up just under 30% of our budget. We would either collapse or price people out, or we'd have to turn them into real. There are parks, you got to remember, 336 miles of coastline is in California State Parks. All of them aren't chargeable entities. So what happens with the maintenance of those if it's not for public funds? What happens to, the ranger who's keeping it? You know, there are people who actually wrestle. Is that the right word? Like wrestle a cow? Is that okay? Wrestle redwood burls. They'll kill a redwood tree. And they would do it in greater detail if it wasn't for rangers. So you need public funding for some parks, and other parks, like our San Diego and Orange County beaches, they make money. But they support Northern California parks. They support Sonoma County parks. If they weren't generating revenues, Sonoma County would be, would be in worse shape. And their senator would really beat me up. Mm-hmm. And she's a tough gal already, okay? But we're not closing any parks because of the symbiotic relationship economically between parks. And that includes having public investment in its parks. All of them are not set up for the free enterprise system to keep them afloat.
Great. Then I am going to thank all of our incredible panelists for joining us today and talking about California State.